I, Alex Reynolds.
I, Alex.
I told you I'd mess up. Okay. I, Alex Reynolds.
I, Alex Reynolds.
Do hereby solemnly swear.
Do hereby solemnly swear.
That I will support, obey, and defend.
That I will support, obey, and defend.
The Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the State of Oklahoma.
The Constitution of the State of Oklahoma.
All laws of the State of Oklahoma.
All laws of the State of Oklahoma.
In the Charter and Ordinances.
In the Charter and Ordinances.
Of the City of Muskogee, Oklahoma.
Of the City of Muskogee, Oklahoma.
And I will not knowingly.
And I will not knowingly.
Receive directly or indirectly.
Receive directly or indirectly.
Any money or other valuable thing.
Any money or any other valuable things.
For the performance or non-performance.
For the performance or non-performance.
Of any act or duty.
Of any act or duty.
Pertaining to my office.
Pertaining to my office.
Other than the compensation allowed by law.
Other than the compensation allowed by law.
I further swear that I will faithfully discharge.
I further swear that I will faithfully discharge.
My duties as council member Ward 2.
My duties as council member Ward 2.
Of the City of Muskogee to the best of my abilities.
To the City of Muskogee. Of the City of Muskogee to the best of my abilities.
That's it. Thank you. Congratulations.
We're going to call to order the Finance Committee meeting for November the 18th, 2019. Item number one, please.
Consider approval of Finance Committee minutes of November 4th, 2019.
After reviewing the minutes, are there any corrections or additions to our minutes?
Move for approval. Second.
Have a motion and a second to approve the minutes. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Deputy Mayor Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Evelyn Hibbs.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Alex Reynolds.
Yes.
Jamie Stout.
Yes.
Mayor Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Item number one passes. Item number two, please.
Consider approval of claims for all city departments October 27th, 2019 through November 8th, 2019.
Do we have a report from the Purchasing Committee?
The Purchasing Committee met. We did not have a quorum, but the staff did answer the questions that we did have, and everything looks good, so I move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to approve our claims list. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Deputy Mayor Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Evelyn Hibbs.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Alex Reynolds.
Yes.
Jamie Stout.
Yes.
Mayor Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Item number two passes. Item number three, please.
Discuss, review, and provide direction to staff regarding Council Policy 1-2, particularly in regard to the manner in which items may be placed on committee or council meeting agendas or take other necessary action.
Deputy Mayor Johnson.
Thank you, Councilor. At the OML conference, there was a number of things that come up that were really good suggestions, and this was one of them that I felt like. Right now, we kind of have a procedure that if you call in and let the city manager or you let the city attorney know, you can have something put on the agenda. And I think it has worked really well for the city of Muskogee. But I think there is also other processes that can work really good. And one of the things that I think is kind of not as good about our process, that can be cleaned up about our process, say I would just call and maybe I would do something that wasn't the wisest thing, and I would just say, hey, I want to rename a street Wayne Johnson Boulevard, and I just put it on the, I wanted it put on the agenda, and the manager was kind of put in that position where he needed to put that on the agenda. That wouldn't be very wise of me, but that's just something that I wanted to do, and it would be put on the agenda, and it would be put out there public like that. A lot of the cities have a procedure that you have to have another counselor co-sponsor something before it goes on the agenda. And I really think that is a good process. So you vent it to one of your peers. So say something crazy like that. If I just wanted to do something like that, I would have to call Marlon and say, hey, Marlon, I want to rename a street. And Marlon would be pretty nice about it and go, I mean, I don't think that's really wise of you to do something like that. You know, you really need to rethink that. Or I could call a former counselor like Dan Hall, and he'd go, you know, that's stupid, Wayne. You know? So I just think it's really a good idea to run something by your peers prior to putting it on council before it's just put out there to public. That is just one of the ideas that was suggested at OML. One of them that they had is you would have to get a co-counsel to sponsor it, and then there would be a waiting period. I wasn't for that because something may be pressing and it needed to be put on the agenda. So I wasn't for that. But a lot of cities have different processes for something to be put on the agenda. So why I put this on there, I would like to just request for staff to look at how would be the best thing to review how it's going on the agenda and how we could better facilitate it where it wouldn't take up time from the staff, but there'd be a coordinated effort. Like right now, it can go to three different people, and I think there can be some conflicting information about that, but we would just have a process that they would come back and submit to us as city council as a recommendation to us, and we would see what that process would look like.
All right, do we have any discussion?
Yeah, may I be recognized, Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Mr. Johnson, what made you all of a sudden come up with this idea? How long has this been going on the way we do it now? Because the councilman can put anything on that agenda we want. How long has it been going on since we've been able to put anything we want on the agenda without having to get permission? And I know when I put my items on the agenda, I always go to you, Mr. Miller or Mr. Tucker. And it's been like that ever since I've been, when I was at the mic, when I came up here to city council, to be up a councilman, it's been the same way. All of a sudden, it wants to change. And I know why it wants to change, because Mr. Johnson, last week when I brought to your attention about those houses, that's the reason you want to change it now, out of all this time. But when a councilman tells another councilman that they're racist, they're a bully, that's wrong. That's wrong. In a showboat. That's what I was told I was up here. That offended me. But you don't see me trying to change the agenda.
Mr. Fain, it is not why I'm wanting to change it. I'm wanting to clean up the process of why we are putting things on it to make it easier for staff and easier for it to go on the agendas. And I think it's very wise for us to just call. We've got nine different people that can be calling staff, and it would be a coordinated effort. I'm not saying that this is the way. I'm just saying that we would recommend to staff to come back and make a recommendation to us of how it would go. But I think to ask for there to be a co-sponsor to it, there's been items from a number of us that have come that have never had a second and have consumed a lot of time.
Well, a lot of times, you know, when you consume a lot of time, the time is worth it. But I disagree with this item here, what you're trying to do here, because I know what it's about. It's about me. You know?
Sir, it's not.
It's about me, Councilman Johnson. Because you, that night, before I even put those pictures up there, you come to me and say, no, we don't want to do this, Ivory, because we're afraid we're going to lose funding from the foundation. So be it. People needed to see what was on those pictures.
Mr. Van, this is not related to, I mean, Chairman, this is your meeting, your chair, but this is really related to items that would go on the agenda. And all I'm asking is that we go to staff and look at how they would want them to go on and come back with recommendations to us. It wouldn't be that you would have to have a co-sponsor. It may be that you would have to have two. It may be that there would be a waiting period. It would just be recommendations. I would just like to look at a process that would clean it up instead of just one person could call and have something put on the agendas. If you look, we've had hunting in the city limits put on the agenda. We've had forerunners put on the agenda. We've had a number of things put on the agenda that we didn't even get a second to. I think we can be professionals and move forward.
Okay, we have a presentation by Mr. Johnson. Do we have any direction from staff at this point, or would it be safe to table this and pick this back up in council communication lunches, or what is the pleasure of the council, of the committee?
I make a motion to shut it down, not to go with Mr. Johnson's suggestion.
I believe, Roy, if I'm correct, we just directing staff, does this require a motion? I think what we're more so looking for is direction on.
If you're going to direct staff to do a study, mm-hmm. And to look at what other cities are doing and come back and make a recommendation, mm-hmm. because that will take more than an hour of staff time, there does need to be a motion to make that happen.
And that was my recommendation, and that is my motion.
Okay. Well, currently we have a motion from Ivory. Do we have a second on this motion? Okay. So the procedure is to acknowledge Wayne's motion?
Yes. Because okay. Mr. Van's motion would fail for lack of a second, and so then you can entertain another motion. I think Deputy Mayor has made one.
All right. Deputy Mayor, Mr. Van, your motion has died due to a second. So currently we have another motion by Mr. Johnson at this time. Do we have a second to his motion? All right.
That motion would then fail for lack of a second. So, Mr. Chairman, then you could call to see if there are any other motions related to this item.
Any other motions related to this item? All right. We move forward. Robert's rules. All right. With that being said, that is the final item on our finance committee for this week.
Now we'll call to order the Public Works Committee meeting of November the 18th, 2019. Item number one, please.
Consider approval of Public Works Committee minutes of November 4th, 2019.
Any questions?
Move the approval.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Deputy Mayor Wayne Johnson?
Yes.
Evelyn Hibbs?
Yes.
Patrick Kale?
Yes.
Marlon Coleman?
Yes.
Ivory Van?
Yes.
Derek Reed?
Yes.
Alex Reynolds?
Yes.
Jamie Stout?
Yes.
Mayor Janie Boydston?
Yes.
Item number one passes. Item number two, please.
Consider approval to award a contract to the lowest and best bid, McGuire Brothers Construction Incorporated, for the 30-inch waterline improvements project for the base bid amount of $3,800,721 and alternate one for $78,000 for a total amount of $3,878,721 or take other necessary action.
Mr. Riley, please.
Yes. This is our... bids for McGuire Brothers is a low bidder on this. Is a 30-inch water line. It's the 3-mile water line that goes from up near the railroad bridge on Shawnee all the way to 69, where it goes over the bike path there. It goes along the bike path corridor. This line will effectively reduce our water age on the west side of town from what is now 11 to 12 days to 3 to 5 days. So that decreases our violations. This is part of the OWRB loan. The alternate for the $78,000, that's for the contractor to use our old Chicago Street yard, and then at the end of construction to tear that building down and remove it so that we can then market that lot. So we had 11 bids and very good bids, and low bid of $3.8 million is we recommend approval.
I've got a question. So what are we doing at the Chicago Street yard?
The contractor is going to use it for to keep their materials during construction, and then before the project's over, they have to remove that building.
Okay, but what have we been doing anything with it lately?
Oh, no.
Okay, that's I thought we were in operation or something.
No, the roof collapsed and we
yeah, no, I, that's yeah. what I thought. I thought, well, mm-hmm. God, it seems like it's been awful lonely looking over there to me. My next question is this the Honor Heights water distribution that little
yeah,
go from
this,
10
this
or 11
line
days
that,
to 3 days?
The main purpose of this line is to fill that tank. There's not very many, currently won't be any branches off of that line. It just pumps water straight to the tank to fill it up, and then also the Radio Hill tank in conjunction with that. But it's putting the water straight there, and then it's feeding out of the tanks, which is using the water as opposed to the water sitting in the tanks, using the water that's being pumped. What's going on right now.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was aware that we had a problem that we're resolving southwest of town.
Right.
I wasn't aware that we had a stagnation problem.
Well, that's part of the whole overall problem, because both of those tanks, they're connected, but the Radio Hill tank is not getting used as much. So yeah. We're repiping and making all that work out.
Thank you, Mr. Riley.
I have a question. Will this have anything to do with the water pressure on the west side of town?
Nothing in this would change the water pressure to where we're at.
That's too bad.
You want
Mr. Riley, the bid process for the demolition of that building, was that a part of a larger bid, or how did we?
Yeah, it was taken as an alternate to the base bid for the whole project.
Okay.
And it varied from, I think 78 was the low, and up to 250 on
okay.
some bids. So.
Any other questions from committee on item number 2?
Move for approval.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Roll call.
Deputy Mayor Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Evelyn Hibbs.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Ivory Vance.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Alex Reynolds.
Yes.
Jamie Stout.
Yes.
Mayor Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Item number 2 passes. Item number 3, please.
Receive annual report on industrial pretreatment program performance summary and take other necessary action.
Mr. Riley.
Yes, Mr. Chairman of Committee. Abigail Wright is going to give us our yearly pretreatment program performance summary.
Mr. Wright.
Hello, how are y'all? Oh, never mind. Can you everybody hear me? Okay. The city is required by our by the EPA and DEQ to implement a pretreatment program, sure. And I'm supposed to report on that annually. And this program regulates wastewater discharge of certain industrial users classified as significant by EPA. And I'm supposed to report any significant violations we had, and I'm proud to report we didn't have any significant violations this year. And I do have the summary attached, which shows all of the inspections done and samplings done that are required as part of the program. And I would be happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much. That's some really good news. Any questions from committee? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Do I have a motion? Or do we need action on this item?
I think you can just receive the report.
Yeah, receive mm-hmm. the report.
Okay. We're just receiving the report. No action is needed on this item. Item number 4, please.
Receive report from staff related to the baling of hay within the city limits or take other necessary action.
Before Tish Callahan addresses this item, I just want to let everybody know I have received one person to wishing to speak to this item. Are we wanting to receive the report from Tish first? Okay. Ms. Callahan.
Thank you. Let me see if I can break it. There we go. So sad. thank you. And committee, this is a request. It was a direction to staff to do a report on the baling of hay within the city limits. And in doing that research, we did contact the multiple cities around Oklahoma through the APA. It was the as a bulk emailing, as it stated in the packet there that you have. And it was also we contacted those that we spoke to at the Quad State Conference that was in Tulsa this year. I also researched online through our Muni code, which has the all the city's codes and ordinances. I did not find any city in the state of Oklahoma that had any restrictions on the baling of hay. Now, all of them have the same or similar to the same ordinance that we do. Some of them do have it to where the height is 10 inches. Some of them have it to where the distance of the buffer zone in agriculture to residential is not the 150. It might be the 50 feet that you have to keep mowed under the 12 inches, which ours is. But the only differences would have been there were some that had the 10-inch height before there was a code violation, or most of them, generally all of them, had the 12-inch high. Currently, we do have several areas that do bale when their grass gets tall. It is a feasible means to remediate the situation where there is the tall weeds and grass. If there is any means to bale the hay, most of them generally, in talking to the OSU Extension, would not profit or have any reason to bale anything unless it was over 2 acres. They don't make, they spend more than they make if they even just mow it, to mow it, rake it, and then bale it. To make a profit and to have good hay, you would need to spray it, treat it. So a lot of these, if they're baling it, is just to remediate the issue of having the weed abatement, the nuisance of the tall weeds and grass. So in saying that, and all the current areas that would then be grandfathered in and allowed to remain baling hay under the legal nonconforming, staff recommends not changing the ordinance and restricting the baling of hay, but to continue with the 12-inch weed abatement nuisance code enforcement. Happy to answer any questions.
Anyone have any questions?
Okay.
It's not me in charge.
Thank you very much. Now we have one person signed up to speak to this item, Teresa Rutlinger. If you would give us your name and address. Okay. Teresa Rutlinger waives her right to speak. So that will conclude. So do we need any action on this, or is this just receiving the report at this time?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
May I be recognized? Exactly. How's this go, Ms. Callahan? I must have missed it, but go ahead and explain to me again. So you
problem?
When it gets 12 inches high.
Yes.
People can still bale hay.
We don't have anything that says they cannot. If that is a means in order to remove the tall weeds and grass, that has been a way that, that a lot of the people have removed the tall weeds and grass when it gets above 12 inches.
Okay, what I'm saying is, though, as it stands now, when it gets 12 inches high, code enforcement goes out and tells them they have to cut it.
Yes.
So if they don't cut it within a 2 weeks' time, the grass is still growing, and, you know, grass grows.
Yes.
They still gonna have the right to bale hay, am I correct?
Yes.
Okay.
By our ordinance.
I don't have anything against baling hay, but I have something against baling it. It's where you bale it. And the cities you named, you said you couldn't find one in Oklahoma. You didn't check with Lawton, Oklahoma. Because Lawton, Oklahoma, you got to be zoned agriculture to bale hay. And we, that's the reason Eagle Crest came up here, because, and we, you know, we had problems out there with the hay baling. They didn't start baling hay until our tractors, city tractors, went out there and cut, using our code to cut the grass. And that's when the owner of the property started baling hay. And he bales that hay, he leaves that hay piled up out there, and those neighbors have got to look at it. If you got a $200,000, $300,000 home, you don't want to look at that. Now, if we go out west on Muggy Street, where no houses are, I have no problem with baling hay out there. I have cattle. I need hay. But when you got it in areas like that, that's trying to beautify their community, and it's dusty, and when they leave those bales of hay setting up in the summertime, snakes and everything else can
be. Mr. Vane, how is that? We're just right now receiving a report, and I don't know how that would be as far as addressing to her. If you had concerns, you could address it with the manager.
Mr. Johnson, Councilman Johnson.
I brought
this item on the agenda in the first place, and I need a, I have the right to say what I think.
I just don't think she should be got on to.
I'm not getting on Ms. Callahan.
That's how it appears.
Okay, Ms. Callahan, if I'm getting on you, I'll apologize personally. Okay. It's amazing how people can get on me, but they don't give me an apology. But that's okay, Ms. Callahan. But I'll go ahead and sit. Go ahead and sit down.
And to be right, I may not have checked Lawton. I did look on the through the code ordinances of those that were on Muni Code. I did not contact a lot of them personally because we had gotten the email, and then we did talk to several that were at the Quad State Conference.
You can be seated now, Ms. Callahan. I'll talk for myself.
Okay.
In the first place, Councilman Johnson. Like I said, I have no problem with going out west side of town where you're going out towards Okmulgee, on out in there. They build a lot of hay out there. You know, there's no houses around them. But when you go to the Eagle Crest Edition and you go to the other editions here in Muskogee, even out there, if you got $300,000 house and you got a lot and somebody's baling hay right there on that lot, we have a problem. And me and Councilman Reed, we're in Ward 3, and we were the only ones dealt with this problem at the Eagle Crest, when they was having all the problems about. That's why Mr. Kovich went to bail the hay, because that was his way of getting back at the city, because we went out there and cut his land, his grass. And if we're going to enforce our 12 inches, it needs to be for everybody, even for the people that's got the houses right here in the city limits. Now, in Lawton, you don't bail hay unless you zoned agriculture. I did check with them myself. But what I'm saying is, I don't feel it's right that we, other citizens out there, has got to pay the penalties and costs when it gets 12 inches and above. We got our contractors to go out there. We could do Eagle Crest, but we don't get there in time. So he's got it. They got it down now where they can do what they want to do. That's what I'm trying to make my point.
Okay. So right now we're just receiving, and what I'm trying to get to. Right now, we're just receiving a report from staff regarding this item, and we've received that. What direction are you wanting to go?
Well, I'm trying to get away from certain areas of town bailing hay. That's the area I want to go. You know, that's the area I want to go. Just like I say, an example on Gulick Street. And also on 24th, I'll tell you another perfect example. On 24th Street, where you're getting ready to put that pretty street down, right there at Shawnee, where those buildings are, all that is baled, but it grows high. You to get good hay, you spray it. That stuff's not sprayed. When I buy my hay from the people I buy my hay from, they spray the grass, good Bermuda grass. But you got weeds all in that hay, but you still got to let it get up that high, and it gets up higher than that. Probably if you get two cuts out of it. I know a little something about farming, Mr. Johnson.
Ms. Callahan, I've but you're fine. In and around town, and I notice on South York, doesn't seem to cause anybody any problems, and it doesn't seem to look real bad, but I notice that they do some baling of hay or maybe brush hogging after it gets pretty high, and every now and again it gets maybe too high, but not very often. And so I'm sure that scenario is all over town somewhere.
I mean, several areas identified.
So yes. It's impractical to say in it, you know, because no one could abide, and it wouldn't, you know. But does it make sense on any level to tie certain agricultural areas that adjoin residential subdivisions, where we could say, okay, if you're agricultural in town, you can do, you know, 10 inches or 12 inches, and you can brush hog it or mow it, and if you don't exceed that, but I still think you need a buffer.
We have that.
Yeah, okay. So you got to have your buffer, but you can do that. Okay, everybody's cool. If you align up with a residential subdivision, then you have to have a buffer, and you have to do this, or it can't exceed 6 inches, or you can brush hog it, but it can't exceed 4. I don't know, but did you see anything like that out there when you were doing your research, or would something like that even be worth considering maybe?
You would still get in the same situation that anything that's over 12 inches should be kept mowed. If you have large acreages, you have some that have 13 acres, the corner of Hancock and Country Club.
Mm-hmm.
There's 13 acres.
Perfect
there.
Example.
It looks like it just is about ready to, needs to be baled, or they're getting ready to. It's hard. I am not a farmer. I don't know the waving wheat and the whole thing of Oklahoma. It's beautiful, but I don't know what it needs to look like to be baled to be enticing to cattle. So, but there was a lot of them. Davis Field Airport, it looks like it's ready for a second cutting, although there's still bales of hay sitting out there. We have the fire station area that's on Peak Boulevard, Southside Industrial Park. We keep that cleared by allowing it to be baled. There's Bacon College along York Street. They have a large parcel that would be very expensive to keep and regularly mowed, and that's next to residential.
And that's what I'm looking for. Mm-hmm. So if it adjoins residential, we're commonly doing that.
Yes, you're required to have the 150-foot buffer if you're zoned agriculture to keep it mowed down. But to have something that has 10 to 15 acres and have someone that would have to mow it 2 and 3 times a month to keep it under that 12 inches is very expensive.
And you just answered my question. There are other scenarios where there's residential neighborhoods adjoining large bodies of land, and it's all being handled.
Yes.
Thank you.
Any other questions from the committee?
I'd just like to say I don't have any problem, Ms. Callahan, with I know which Councilman Kale is talking about on York Street, but you got 16th Street where Furniture Factory Outlet is. That's not no big acreage. That used to be baled, but he got sick and he can't build it anymore. Now it just grows up. Right now it's grown up. Only thing that's got it down is the frost. I have no problem against baling, but I just have a problem when it's around people's $300,000 homes or more around their homes, and this person is doing it on purpose. Because the first time they done it, we were on a holiday. I ain't never seen it done out there. But would you say the city doesn't have the equipment to keep up with the stuff if it wasn't bailing it?
I would say that, yes.
I would say that, too, yes. Because they do not, even on these lots.
Because you have to brush hog it. You're not. I did learn that. You do have to brush hog it. It's not just a regular mower. And even our residential lots that exceed that 12 inches, and then you have that time frame between the notice and it actually goes to the contractor, and it depends on the weather and how fast the grass is growing. There were times we said we could just sit and watch the grass grow with the rain and the lovely weather. So with that, even there's times that they have to take a tractor to a residential house, and quite honestly, it looks bad after it's mowed. It's not a pretty sight. I would rather it be mowed, raked, and baled, even if they could do just the front yard, but that's my personal preference versus how they have to handle getting it down to the 12 inches.
Well, I have no problem with it. Like I said, if on 24th Street, when people are going down Shawnee, if you got them bales that's been sitting there a long time, I mean, like I said, they probably get two cuttings out of that. They've been sitting there a while, and they're coming through our town. That tells them what we're about.
And that's something that could be addressed, that if they want to have code enforcement, have the bales of hay removed after 30 days, have that added, that if they do end up baling it, have those that they're required to be removed within a certain amount of time. The highway department has that when they do the highway mowing and they allow it to be baled, they require that the bales are removed within the 30 days.
You just said it. If they remove those bales instead of having them sitting, you know, that would help some, quite a bit. It would dress our city up. Because like I said, we're getting ready for a nice, pretty 24th Street and got bales of hay sitting there this summer. Just sitting. Bales of hay shouldn't sit that long. Farmers can take them and put them up.
And that is a suggestion that we could have it put in there with code enforcement that we're required to remove the bales if they do, even in agriculture zoning classifications.
I'm done, Mr. Chairman. I'll turn the floor back over to you.
Any other questions from the committee?
I just want to say thanks to Tish for everything and all the work that she's been putting into research this.
Thank you. Thank you. I learned. Farm. I may be a farmer now.
Yes, there is a lot of agriculture in our community.
Yes,
that's for sure. It was quite an in-depth look at it.
Matter of fact, Ms. Callahan, I just went the other night to the Cattlemen's Association. Well, they had some good steak.
They were not fed in with
steak.
A lot of hay that came from Muskogee that's been baled.
And you didn't bring any of us back any?
Well, Mr. McPeak gave me 8 steaks, and Pam cooked them for me for breakfast.
And I thought about y'all. 8 steaks without sharing with Marlon Coleman.
If we could get back to the Public Works agenda, I know we're having a good time, but that will conclude our Public Works agenda for this evening.
And now... we will try to be a little more respectful and reasonable, and we will call to order the November 18, 2019 special call meeting of the Muskogee City Council. If we could have the roll call.
Mayor Janie Boydston.
Here.
Evelyn Hibbs.
Here.
Alex Reynolds.
Here.
Marlon Coleman.
Here.
Jamie Stout.
Here.
Deputy Mayor Wayne Johnson.
Here.
Patrick Kale.
Here.
Ivory Van.
Here.
Derek Reed.
Here.
Thank you. Item one.
Consider approval to authorize the city manager to negotiate and execute an inspection contract in an amount not to exceed $135,000 for construction inspection of the 24th Street Improvements Project and other street projects, or take other necessary action.
Mr. Riley.
Yes, Mayor and Council. Good news today, if you were on that side of town, the 24th Street Project started aggressively today. They closed down the south half, which is MLK to Okmulgee, and started milling off the asphalt. A little bit of growing pains with people getting used to the new traffic routes they have to take. And we've made a few adjustments to some signs to help that out. But it's normal to take a few days to get everyone used to where they need to go when you close down a street like this. So, but the work's proceeding, and it's going great so far. This construction inspection, looked at, as we discussed in council of or in committee, about the construction inspection on the 24th Street project. We looked at the options of in-house and outside independent inspection.
Pardon me, Greg, if I can interrupt, just as a prelude and to acknowledge how we got to where we're at. Forgive me, because Greg's going to make a good presentation, but we have discussed this a couple of times. I want to thank Councilor Reed and Councilor Van for bringing this up about our ideas about having more in-house inspection, especially as it relates to about $45 million worth of public works, water and sewer projects that up to a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, we weren't able to do. And we've got the funding for, and now our new city streets projects that we're going to have $24 million worth of street projects. So with all of that going forward, different than more and better and different projects than we've had in the past, we've got good ideas to pause and look at how we've done things in the future and possibly do them differently in the future. So I want to thank you guys for bringing that up, and that's what Greg's going to look at.
Yeah, and that's a good point that, you know, we're in a different place than we've been in the past. We've got $45 million worth of water and sewer work, and then we're adding on top of that the street work, which will be another $6 million a year, so a total of $24 million. So we got a lot more work than we have in the past. Currently, we have one in-house inspector, and we've been hiring an inspector to do the sewer and water work. So the advantage of the in-house inspection, you're using your city personnel assigned as needed, and it is flexible in that, and you have some internal control of the projects. When you look at that in-house inspector, depending on experience, but when you throw in the overtime and the vehicle, computer, everything they need for inspection, we're around $6,500, $7,500 a month for hiring an inspector. Disadvantages: expertise gets limited unless you find somebody that's done a little bit of everything. Arrangements have to be made for after hours, vacation, and sick unless you have a staff. We looked at some other cities, larger cities, Broken Arrow, Fort Smith, and such have 5 to 6 inspectors with a supervisor, and that works well for them because they're not all street inspectors. They have a multitude of different types of inspectors that can interchange where they need to be on the projects. And in slower times, with our own inspectors, they're just slow when the bad weather and stuff, and there's no work going on. And then getting them trained while they're trying to inspect a project gets very difficult, and they're not independent to the city. Our plan of action in our with our in-house inspector is to use that inspector to help get the continue getting the 100-mile street program going. That's a high priority, and a lot of inspection will be required when that gets going next year. And get more training, and then
look, I want to build project management staff to meet our needs in the future. I'm in favor of in-house inspection. I just can't snap my fingers and make it happen today with what we have. Outside inspection advantages, you got flexibility that you can work it into your contracts. All-inclusive contractors working, the inspector has to be there. They have their own car and office and computer and everything. You can get more specialized inspectors on the site using a firm that has a multitude of inspectors. If something changes on the site where we're doing a complicated water line or something, they bring in the person they need to be there during that part of the construction. They adjust to meet the contractor's schedule, independent to engineer, contractor, and the city, and they provide a paperwork for any court proceedings that we have, if anything needs to be done as far as close out on the project. Some disadvantages, it can be put lower in priority. We could be put lower in priority if that contractor has higher priorities to us. It is additional cost, and we have reached out to our local consultant, and they do not have anybody available for the 24th Street project at this time. And they provide oversight and recommendations, not necessarily direct the contractor, but they tell me when something's not going as it needs to be going, and I make the direction. So with our outside inspection, our sewer projects, we've got six separate projects totaling $14.5 million in the last year under construction. They're about 50% complete. Our inspectors provided us over 1,600 daily reports and over 13,000 images. So everything is being documented, and it's all compiled and taking up a lot of room on our servers. They're providing the punch list and clear expectations to the contractor. And the projects are working well. They're coming in on time, within budgets. And overall, our inspection costs are less than 2% of the total construction budget. Originally, we estimated these costs at 5%, which was approved by OWRB as a normal inspection cost on construction. 24th Street project contractor. This contractor, as we discussed, they've moved towards legal remedies in the past. We have awarded to the lowest bidder, I believe we need an on-site independent inspector out there every day. Contract has many phases: street, traffic, water, sewer, storm drain, lots of different things going on. And we need someone out there. I feel like we need a bulldog independent inspector on the job as soon as we can get him out there throughout this project so that everything will be documented. We'll have pictures. We'll have a stack of paperwork so that we can have anything we need in the future to close out the project. The cost to this is about $135,000 for the entire 450-day project, which and then can taper off as the project nears completion. So that's 3% of construction costs, which is very reasonable. Like I said, we use 5% estimate typically for inspection on a project. With this, our plan of a plan of action for our in-house inspector would be to have our independent inspector out there day to day, but use them to help train our inspector for our future street work, and then work towards the future of future projects and have a project management team in the future that we can get some well-trained people to help us through our street program. And so my recommendation is that we authorize the manager to negotiate this agreement for inspection on 24th Street and other street projects.
Mr. Riley, thank you for all this. I enjoyed the education and at our council lunches, and I appreciate what Mr. Reed and Mr. Van had to say a few weeks ago. This is a perfect example of council learning from asking questions of staff, and from staff learning from council what some of our priorities are at times. And to me, this is a plan where everything comes together. We're acknowledging concerns or priorities that this council has, while we're acknowledging that sometimes it's not practical to, practical to go full bore one direction. I appreciate taking the extra time, and I know we're ready to go and we're half nervous, but I appreciate staff taking the additional time to present all this and the lunches, and thank you very much.
Move for approval.
Mr. Chairman, may I be recognized?
Yes.
I'm going to say my piece because I know it's going how this is going to go down tonight. But I'm going to say my piece anyway. This $135,000 that we're spending out of our taxpayers' dollars, I think is wrong. Remember those Councilman Lunchins, Mr. Riley? One question I asked you, what was the first thing they were going to do on 24th Street? You know what that was, right?
Was as far as milling the project, milling the
No,
the
first, road? Very first step they were going to do on 24th Street. I asked you what they were going to do, and you told me that the first thing they were going to do, which I know they got to mill up the street, but they got to put a water line in.
Right.
Okay. Now, you got to have an inspector inspect the water line, correct?
Correct.
Okay. We have a plumbing inspector that carries license. Should say it carries state and city license. That plumbing inspector is going to be a 12-inch line, right?
Yes.
Okay. A 12-inch line. You got a gasket. And you got, like, cream, I'll say. And all you do is, even on the fittings, you buck this together. And the reason I know this is because I'm a plumber. And I carry a state and city license. So I know what I'm talking about. Well, what I'm saying is, if a plumber can't inspect it, and you got a person at the water department that's well qualified, and I'm not calling his name, because he had to do some inspections on Martin Luther King Street. And I think he would, and, you know, we'll promote ourselves in management, but we need to start promoting these people that are working for the water department and getting out in these ditches and doing this hard work. We could promote him to look at, oversee this project on the water line going in ourselves. And I know he's highly qualified. He's got a license to do it. But we won't do that. We'll go hire somebody else from out of town to do it for us, which I don't think is right. And another problem I have is the contractor, that's the problem. We had a decent contractor that we could trust. We wouldn't have all these stipulations on these inspectors and, you know, wouldn't have to look over their shoulders and have them like our staff. But somebody on our staff, I blame the city. Somebody on our staff, like I say, should have been on these projects from day one, years and years ago, back a long time ago.
Mr. Pan, if I may, the reason that we brought this forward is that this is how we have done the major city projects in the past, including the most recent one, 43rd and 45th Street. We had an external third-party contractor. And we did, so that's why we brought it forward, because we felt like this job needed an inspector just as much. 24th Street needed just as much professional attention as 43rd and 45th Street out by Georgia Pacific. So I just wanted to add that as you're talking about, this isn't something new or different. This is what we do on projects of this scope and size.
But Mr. Miller, when you came to doing Ward 4 streets, wasn't no inspector. But except our street department, I hope they, I hope they were out there inspecting. I seen them. And then you came to Ward 3, it wasn't no inspector. But when you was on 43rd, now you're on 24th Street, you got an inspector. How do you think Ward 3 and Ward 4 feels about not having this professionalism, as you say, when we don't have to use them? That's what I'm saying is you have people on staff right now. If you would promote them, go out there and do this water. I'm just saying the water line, for example.
We do have good staff. You're absolutely
We got good staff to know how to put that pipe in and know how to take it out.
But we treat our $4 million jobs different than our smaller jobs. You're absolutely right, and we have in the past. And so what this has brought to light is that we have the opportunity to do things differently in the future, which is what Mr. Riley has outlined. We're going to do more thanks to the ideas that we've come up with, the ideas that council came up with, to do more in-house inspections in the future. That's absolutely what you're proposing and what Mr. Riley has proposed to do in his plan moving forward. But also on certain projects that we might need specialized inspectors. And when we have a major project, a $4 million project, We want to treat this one on 24th Street as with just as much attention and professionalism as we did the one on 43rd and 45th Street. And if we don't, if the city doesn't want to do that, if we want to treat it differently, that's fine too. But that's the attitude. That's how we came to be where we're at. And forgive me for interrupting you, sir. My apologies.
No, it's okay. What I'm saying is, if we do hire, and which I know y'all are, I'm not, but y'all are, this $135,000 company to come in here and do what we can do ourselves with our staff. You know, if they're, I tell you what, Mr. Miller, when we do hire them, our staff needs to be right behind them every day as their apprentice. Because before I became a plumber, I had to be an apprentice first to work up under a plumber.
I think you're giving very good advice.
And they need to be right up underneath that professional. I mean professional. He's got to be a professional. We're paying him this kind of money. They need to be right up under him every day, some of our staff. So that's next time we won't have to be out $135,000 on these $4 million projects and stuff.
I feel like you're reading from Mr. Riley's script right here, because that's what he said. I think we're in agreement.
I'm in agreement on that. I'm telling you, the people that's on our city staff, if they can't do it, I know. Like I say, on the water line, I have no problem, because we don't need no inspector on that water line. I can get you somebody. When we leave out of this meeting tonight, Mr. Miller, I can point out a person to you. I guarantee you, he may have to leave his daily work, but I guarantee he's qualified. He's qualified as the professional that works for Great Plains. But I'm shut it down. But the only thing I'm going to leave you with, I would love, I know Councilman Reed would too, I would love to see. Oh, let me ask you one more question. Mm-hmm. On this $135,000, is it doing Ward 1 streets? Is it doing Ward 2 streets?
So that's number one. That's a not to exceed amount. It may not get that high. We don't anticipate necessarily that it will. But it can't go higher than that over 450 days. And I'll let Mr. Riley address the scope.
Right. That is the scope. But the inspector is here daily. They'll have two inspectors in Muskogee. And if there are other places I need them to inspect, they happily do that, because we're paying them a daily rate, So they'll go and inspect whatever we ask them to inspect, wherever we need them. We'll use our own people also, but we have a lot going on, more than we've ever had. So we need some inspectors out there.
Well, for this, like I say, this inspector, he needs to be on Ward 1. He needs to be in Ward 2, because he, like I say, you can say what you want, but I kind of feel like we're a stepchild. We've mistreated in Ward 3, and I know Ward 4. Now, this 24th Street is in Ward 4, but in Ward 3, it wasn't no inspectors, professional inspectors on those streets. I feel like a stepchild myself. We didn't get that attention. Don't you think we all need to be treated the same? I do. But I'm going to shut it down. But I just hope the inspector, and I think that's the gentleman right there I'm looking at. Sir, I hope and pray that you teach our staff something they don't know, that they should know, so we won't have to call you back. I'll turn the floor back over to you, Ms. the Chairman.
Oh, you're talking to me.
I'm sorry. I forgot I'm in council meeting.
Ms. Mayor? If our inspector doesn't do right, we know you'll be right on him, and he can be warned. I'm sorry, but that is the case.
You know what, Mr. Boston? You know what? You made a good point. But
I didn't mean to get you
started. No, I'm just going to say one more thing. I'm going to say one more thing. You made a good point. We got, this is Ward 4. We got two councilmen up here. They should the ones should be on it. Not me. Because when it comes to Ward 3, me and Councilman Reed, we on it. I went down and looked at the depot, at concrete this morning. But I'll turn the floor back over to you.
Are you finished?
Yes, ma'am. I'll turn the floor back over to you, but I had to make my point.
Would someone like to make a motion on this item?
I did.
We need a second. It's been so long, I forgot. Do we have a second?
And I'll make a second. And again, I want to say, staff took a good suggestion, and we melded it together, and I just think it was a wonderful plan. So
thank you,
Madam Chair. I do empathize and sympathize with what Councilor Van has said, because I've been a proponent for some time that we do need the appropriate training for our staff to be able to do these types of jobs. The concern I have and the indifference I have is that when we did 44th and 43rd Street. It was in an industrial area that took care of businesses. When we did South York, it was the same routine. We did the area for businesses with an inspector. If I'm not mistaken, I believe both parts of Martin Luther King, if not definitely the latter part of Martin Luther King Project to 24th Street, did have an inspector. And what some of the residents in that area did suggest when I was circulating and being in this conversation, they would not want to feel like we went to the cost to have inspections done for industry, but when it was time to do a street through a neighborhood, we didn't have an inspector. And so I appreciate Councilor Van, because I do want all of the areas of the city to be treated correctly. But I do know for a fact that in that area where it's going to be worked on now, I did get several concerns from residents that if we did it for industry areas, as we get ready to move forward with these neighborhood projects, they are concerned that they are done correctly, because what we don't want to happen is have spent $24 million over 6 years for residential neighborhoods without an inspector, and then come back in 10 years and almost have to do all those streets over again because they were done incorrectly.
Any further discussion? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Evelyn Hibbs.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
No.
Derek Reed.
No.
Alex Reynolds.
Yes.
Jamie Stout.
Yes.
Mayor Janie Boydston.
Yes, and the motion carries. Item two.
Consider an executive session to discuss and take possible action on the following. A, pursuant to Section 307, C-11, Title 25, Oklahoma Statutes, consider convening an executive session to discuss matters pertaining to a potential economic development project in the northeast quadrant of the city, including the creation of a proposal to entice the business to locate within the city, and if necessary, take appropriate action in open session. B, pursuant to Section 307(b)(4), Title 25, Oklahoma Statutes, consider convening an executive session to discuss litigation related to the national opioid epidemic, and if necessary, take appropriate action in open session. C, pursuant to Section 307(b)(1), Title 25, Oklahoma Statutes, consider convening an executive session to discuss the employment terms, evaluation, hiring, appointment, demotion, disciplining, resignation, or termination of City Clerk Tammy L. Tracy, and if necessary, take appropriate action in open session.
Make a motion we go into executive session. Second.
Any discussion? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Evelyn Hibbs.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Alex Reynolds.
Yes.
Jamie Stout.
Yes.
Mayor Janie Boydston.
Yes, and the motion carries. Would you please excuse us while we go into executive session? Roll call.
Mayor Janie Boydston.
Here.
Evelyn Hibbs.
Here.
Alex Reynolds.
Here.
Marlon Coleman.
Here.
Jamie Stout.
Here.
Deputy Mayor Wayne Johnson.
Here.
Patrick Kale.
Here.
Ivory Van.
Here.
Derek Reed.
Here.
Mr. Tucker.
Thank you, Mayor. Item 2A, pursuant to Section 307 C-11, Title 25, Oklahoma Statutes, the City Council did convene an executive session to discuss matters pertaining to a potential economic development project in the northeast quadrant of the city, particularly with regard to the creation of a proposal to entice a business to locate within the city. After being briefed on that potential proposal, I believe no action is needed because staff has received the necessary direction to work with the Port of Muskogee to move forward on the proposal to entice the development prospect as discussed in executive session. Item 2B, pursuant to Section 307(b)(4), Title 25, the City Council did convene an executive session to discuss litigation related to the national opioid epidemic. The council was briefed on the status of that potential litigation, and staff has received the necessary direction. We will need a motion on this item, and a proposed motion will be to authorize the city attorney to engage counsel with Fulmer Sill, P LLC for representation in the ongoing opioid litigation on a contingency fee basis, joining approximately 60 other cities and counties in Oklahoma, and further to authorize the city manager to execute the necessary professional services agreement.
So move.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Evelyn Hibbs.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Alex Reynolds.
Yes.
Jamie Stout.
Yes.
Mayor Janie Boydston.
Yes. The motion carries.
Item 2C, pursuant to Section 307B1, Title 25, Oklahoma Statutes, the City Council did convene an executive session to discuss the employment terms, evaluation, hiring, appointment, demotion, disciplining, resignation, or termination of City Clerk Tammy L. Tracy. Ms. Tracy was evaluated in executive session, and certain modifications to her contract were recommended. We do need a motion on this item, and that would be to approve the drafting of a modified contract for the employment of City Clerk Tammy L. Tracy based on terms as discussed in executive session.
Move for approval.
Second.
Any discussion? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Evelyn Hibbs.
Yes.
For the last time, Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Alex Reynolds.
Yes.
Jamie Stout.
Yes.
Mayor Janie Boydston.
Yes. And the motion carries. And that's the last of our business. So we are adjourned.